This is Lisa from Mobile Tech Review, and here we have a product that's a little hard to place in some ways. This is the HP ZBook 15u G3. What a sexy name, right? But for those of you who know the HP ZBook family, they're actually very nice mobile workstations, and there's now the standard ZBook, the ZBook Studio, which is very light, very powerful, and also very expensive, starting around $2,000. And the new 15u G3, means the latest generation, is the affordable one. But the problem is the horsepower inside has been so cut back that it's really not much of a mobile workstation in the sense that they usually are for people who are doing CAD, rendering, all that sort of heavy production work. It's basically an ultrabook in a workstation's clothing. And we're going to look at it now.
This is not a bad looking laptop for a business laptop. Mobile workstations can be downright, well, almost sexy as they go. We have magnesium reinforced surface on top and casing. And on the sides here, you can see it's pretty slim, 19.9 millimeters. It only weighs 4.2 pounds for a 15-inch so-called mobile workstation. Again, that's impressive. Lots of ports here. Now, this side doesn't have too many, but you have your USB, VGA. Remember, it's a business laptop. People still need their VGA. A smart card reader. Yes, some folks still use those. And vents. Despite the fact this does not have a very demanding CPU or GPU, there's plenty of ventilation here on the side and also on the bottom. Now, the other side, there's a lot more action going on, more USB 3.0 ports. We even have a SIM card slot. There's an SD card slot. We have DisplayPort. There is no HDMI, but do you really need it if you have a DisplayPort, especially for a business laptop? And there is one USB-C 3.1 port. This is Gen 1. No Thunderbolt 3 here. You have to look to the more expensive ZBook Studio, a pretty lovely machine, actually. It's not much heavier, but it is a lot more expensive if you want that, or the full-power ZBook 15 and 17-inch model lineup for that. And on the underside, you can actually see the drop-down for the Ethernet connector and the SD card slot. It's a good enough looking machine, and it is MIL spec rugged 810G for dust and water resistance. And our base TN panel right here, 1080p, looks okay as long as you angle it just right. We'll talk more about that. Nice keyboard here with a number pad. I know a lot of you like that, particularly if you're number crunching types. And we actually get a trackpad with discrete keys on it, the eraser stick pointer, all the stuff you'd expect from a business laptop, and a couple of things you might not expect, like Bang Olufsen audio.
Okay, so now that we've had a look around at the ports and discussed the durable design, let's talk about what's inside. And this is where I take issue with this laptop as something that's called a mobile workstation. Now, Lenovo has done much the same thing with the ThinkPad W550S, which is their 15-inch workstation that has Ultrabook CPUs, but still more powerful dedicated graphics. So you actually could get some CAD and 3D design work done with it, albeit, you know, it'd still be nice to have a quad core. But if you do want to lighten your load, and this certainly is a light machine and relatively slim for a workstation, you know, there's an argument for doing something like the dual core CPU. This is a 15-watt Intel Skylake 6th generation CPU. This is a dual core CPU you can get with a Core i5 or a Core i7. That is the same CPU you'll find in Ultrabooks, around 13.3 inches in size, to give you an idea of the performance that we're talking about for CPU prowess. We happen to have the highest end edition, which is a Core i7-6600U, clocked at 2.6 gigahertz. Now, in comparison, this is the Lenovo ThinkPad P50. This is one of their newer workstations that's, relatively speaking, kind of slim and kind of light. It's still going to be heavier, certainly, than the ZBook 15U, but it has very powerful dedicated graphics inside and quad-core CPUs. The footprint is not so different. It is a bit thicker and heavier, but this has a lot of oomph. This competes more directly with HP's regular ZBook and ZBook Studio lines. And here it is with the Microsoft Surface Book, which, interestingly, in terms of horsepower, has a lot more in common with the ZBook 15U than did the Lenovo P50 we just showed you. Surface Book here is a 13.5-inch display. It is smaller. The display, there's only one option on the Surface Book, and it's an excellent display. But this has available the same dual-core i7-6600U CPU and custom NVIDIA dedicated graphics, more towards the GeForce-style graphics there. More consumer-oriented, obviously, so you can get the idea here that in terms of horsepower, we're talking something more like this. Of course, with the Surface Book, number one, there were a lot of driver issues at first that have been sorted out. That's something that your IT department would not love to deploy, obviously, until the bugs were ironed out, which they are now. But there's a lot less ports here. You can get a dock for this, but it doesn't have all the ports built in that something like the HP does. Ah, now we have something that is aimed at businesses with the Lenovo ThinkPad T460S here that we recently did a video review of. This is a 14-inch Ultrabook, again, the same dual-core CPUs, just Intel HD 520 graphics, though, but the low-end AMD FirePro W4190M graphics in the HP doesn't add a whole lot of extra oomph, to be honest, but here we do get a lot of ports. You got your Ethernet, you've got multiple USBs, you have DisplayPort, so this one actually is a much smaller, lighter possibility if you're looking to deploy something to your regular staff members, not really to your CAD engineering design folks. Lastly, we have the Dell XPS 13 with the Infinity Display. It's available 1080p or 4K display. Both are excellent displays. And this is the laptop everybody loves to love because it has a fast quad-core Skylake CPU and NVIDIA GTX 960M graphics. Now, GeForce is aimed more at gaming than at CAD work, though it can handle CAD work just fine, but there aren't as many optimizations there. Decent number of ports here, not really that fantastic because it has USB-C / Thunderbolt 3 and Dell expects you to use their dongles, docks, and adapters to do that. Of course, there's also the Dell Latitude version of this for folks who are more business CAD oriented. Now, when we open it up and take a look inside, nice, sturdy, good presentation here. Your keyboard's down just slightly, better ergonomics for typing, and also the keys won't hit the screen. We actually have buttons, discrete buttons for the trackpad, and that's a nice thing to have, something that you'll see only on select business laptops, hardly ever on consumer anymore. Keyboard is backlit. It's a pleasant keyboard to type on, not particularly sculpted or shaped keys, but all in all, it's quite nice. You get your number pad over here. You have the eraser stick pointer if you're migrating from ThinkPad land and you miss the eraser stick pointer dearly. There's a little bit of flex right over here, off to the side, but it's very, very teeny. Unless you're somebody who really womps the keyboard hard when you type, I don't think that's going to bother you very much. You got a fingerprint scanner here. It's the old-fashioned slit kind that you slide your finger across. It is not the kind that you lay your finger on. And something we hardly see on laptops anymore, over here we have quick control turning your audio on and off and your wireless on and off. So that's nice to have, and the power button, of course, is up here, so you won't accidentally hit that when you're typing. As we look upward, things get less exciting. The base model for this, and again, for a Core i7 dual core, this starts around $1,130 or so, which, you know, is not that much for a business-oriented so-called mobile workstation, but let's talk about that. The base model is a TN display. You can get it with touch, which this one happens to have, or without touch. It is... I haven't seen a display this sad in years, honestly. It's a throwback to the bad old times of viewing angles where you really have to angle it just right. You can see how the display washes out and disappears very easily. Contrast is low on it. This is not a good display, folks. If you have any say in the purchase process, so you're buying it yourself, opt for the optional IPS displays. HP calls their wide viewing angle displays. That's available in 1080p or 4K, and they'll be much better looking than this one, and obviously you won't have to tilt it back and forth just to find the sweet spot of viewability. Now, display brightness on this isn't too bad on our 1080p touch model. We have it at max brightness where it can almost seem to wash out the picture. As we drop it down, you can see it can't fight the glare of the lights really well in our studio. At 280 nits, that's not so bad. Contrast ratio is only 350 to 1. We like to see 680 to 1 and higher, but because the black levels are quite high on this, at maximum brightness, the black levels are 0.8. We like to see around 0.4. It doesn't get very black, in other words. Color gamut, also not good. 79% of sRGB, only 50% of Adobe RGB. This is not for professionals who are doing design and graphics work where color accuracy comes anything close to counting. Again, get the higher end panel on this if you want. The challenge is if you start upgrading this an awful lot, well, you're starting to verge on the price of a regular ZBook 15, and I might opt for that myself. And there's no dream color display option here. That's a lovely wide gamut color display that is available on the higher end ZBook models. So how about horsepower and performance? Again, this is going to be more like your average dual-core Ultrabook and not so much like a more expensive ZBook model or Lenovo's high-end workstations or the Dell XPS 15 or the equivalent in the Latitude market. Still, it scores pretty well. Now, this is available with your choice of a SATA 3 or a PCIe NVMe SSD drive. It has an M.2 slot. It's compatible with both kinds of drives. And it has a 2.5-inch drive bay for a conventional spinning hard drive, if you buy it configured that way from HP. 5400 or 7200 RPMs are available. Or you could put a solid-state SSD in a 2.5-inch drive bay, too. Anyway, we have the fast NVMe SSD, the 256-gig model. It's also available with 512 gigs. So that helps with scores like PC Mark 8 that loves fast storage. But still, that number is about the best of the numbers that we're going to see here. And 3629 for the PC Mark Home 8 accelerated test is quite good. For Geekbench 3, you can see the scores right there. That's about what we expect to see from the Core i7-6600U. It's pretty close to what the high-end Surface Book scored. For example, it has two cores, so the multi-core score is 7634, which is good, but it's almost half of what you'd see in a quad-core. Now for our 3D tests here, this is the 3D Mark Firestrike test where it scored 1601. The scores here are going to be a little bit better than integrated graphics, but not a whole lot. Now the AMD FirePro W4190M is optimized to do well with CAD programs particularly, and not necessarily in any other kind of graphics chore, say compared to some consumer graphics options, again, like NVIDIA GeForce cards, but roughly it's equivalent to something like the NVIDIA 840M to 940M, so something like the Lenovo ThinkPad P40, for example. Now for 3D Mark 11, the P score, we got P2602. Then that's a good, decent bit better than something with just integrated graphics alone, where typically we see a score of around 1650 or so. Now, if you look at something with, say, the GTX 960M or a higher-end Quadro, NVIDIA Quadro card, even not one of their really high-end cards, you're going to see even higher scores, but the best scores will be close to 10,000 to give you an idea of the range that this can run. Now, here's where we really are impressed. That PCIe SSD there, look at the scores on that. That is phenomenal stuff there. That's certainly better than a lot of other competing brands that are also running with NVMe PCIe SSD drives, which HP likes to call their Turbo Z drive. So if you're shopping for one, that's what that means. You're getting the fast SSD. So if you do a lot of file copying or large file copying, you're going to enjoy the speeds. Now, given the fact that those drives are available in 256 and 512 gig capacities, HP probably figures you're storing your large files primarily on the 2.5-inch hard drive that you have there. So keep that in mind. Okay, so one of the hallmarks of a mobile workstation or a business laptop is that you actually can open it up and upgrade it and access the internals. You can do that here, and you know, you don't see any screws, do you? That's because under 10 separate rubber plugs here, there are Phillips head screws, good old standard Phillips head screws, that's good, but these rubber plugs are pretty annoying, particularly if you don't have fingernails. If you use a pokey tool, you have to be careful not to rip them. Fortunately, they're not attached with adhesive, so you're not going to rip them apart like that or have them not stick again. But there are 10 of those buggers, and they're not all the same. So I suggest taking them and laying them on the table just as you took them out so you figure out which one goes in which hole, because they're slightly different angles, slightly different thicknesses. Oh, boy. And, there's when you're done with that, there's one more screw. You have to take out your SD card blank here, and there's one more little teeny Phillips head screw right there. Now, your IT department probably just dies a little every time they have to open up something like this, but at least they can. And inside, you have access to the M.2 slot. You've got the battery that you can access. It's not one of the traditional workstations where there's just a latch lever and you pop the battery out, obviously. You do have to open it up to get to it. You have access to the 2.5-inch drive bay, the wireless card, which is a good Intel latest generation 8260. It's a Wi-Fi 802.11ac card with Bluetooth 4.2. So it's pretty serviceable, and there are two RAM slots, and HP includes DDR4 RAM, which is nice to see because a lot of machines with Ultrabook CPUs are still shipping with DDR3 low power RAM. So actually got two RAM slots, so the maximum is 32 gigs if you use two 16 gig modules. So take that Ultrabooks, because most of them have RAM that's soldered on board, and you get 8 gigs if you're lucky, maybe 16 gigs depending on the model. So for those of you who really need a lot of RAM, that is something that is a more workstation-like feature that you do get here. Now, one thing that's nice about having a dual core and a pretty low performance dedicated graphics card is you don't have to have a charger that weighs as much as a 12-inch MacBook. Here's a little old 65-watt charger that you'd see with other Ultrabooks with, say, the NVIDIA 940M graphics card inside. So less to carry there, a traditional charger, plenty of cord length on it. You would think that battery life should be awesome, too. Look at the Lenovo ThinkPad W550S, which has, you can use up to two batteries, of course, so you're going to get more oomph there. This just has the battery that's built in, but this is a 3-cell 46-watt-hour battery, which is about the same battery capacity we'd see on a 13-inch Ultrabook. So runtimes are about like that, and you know, you're powering two drives here, and potentially, we're talking about the 1080p display, 4K probably will have worse, but on average, this does about 6.5 hours. So it's, compared to some of today's better running workstations, that's actually not that impressive runtime, and it's not really going to beat the pants off of something like the XPS 15 with the 1080p display, or even HP's standard ZBook 15 Studio, for example. So that's the HP ZBook 15u G3, which is currently latest generation. That's what G3 means in HP lingo. I'm sure there's a place for this. I'm sure some corporations are going to buy this, and probably for their workers who actually aren't doing much mobile workstation stuff. That is not a lot of CAD engineering and development stuff, but for everyday productivity, and they might buy it because it has a lot of ports, because they get good volume deals from HP buying a whole bunch of HP laptops, because it's pretty darn durable. So you don't have to worry about your sales force or anybody else dropping this and it breaking. It probably won't. It'll withstand some tough treatment. But as a mobile workstation, for those of you who are looking to buy it for yourselves or to ask your boss to buy it, if you are doing CAD, 3D rendering, that sort of thing, really, you want something with a quad-core CPU and definitely higher-end dedicated graphics. I'm Lisa from Mobile Tech Review. Be sure to visit our website for the full written review and subscribe to our YouTube channel for more cool tech videos.